Hello everyone, welcome to the road to the Mainline ZynqMP VCU driver. My name is Michael Tretter. I work at Pangotronics as part of the graphics team. The main focus of my work are graphic drivers, GPU and display drivers, GStreamer, video encoders and decoders, and basically Linux kernel drivers. I will guide you along the path to a Linux mainline video encoder driver. So our stops are as follows. We will start with the overview of our platform, the Xilinx ZynqMP UltraScale MPSoC. Then we will take a closer look at the VCU, which is the IP core for the encoder, which we will discuss. We will take a look at the reference manual and the software support by Xilinx for this core. Then we will look at video encoders in mainline Linux, which APIs are discussed, are used there, and how they are usually implemented. And then we will go into the nitty-gritty technical details of the Allegro driver, look at some VCU hardware peculiarities, which had to be overcome, and then look at the current state as supported features in this driver, and finally take a look into the future where I'm planning to go with the driver. So let's start with the ZynqMP. There are various names for the ZynqMP. Some just call it Zynq, which might cause confusion with the Zynq 7000. Some just call it UltraScale. I will stick to the term ZynqMP. So whenever I say ZynqMP, you know that I mean any of the previous terms. So for the platform, I can recommend a talk by Luca on the FOSDEM 2018, where he goes into great detail about the ZynqMP and the Linux support for that. I even stole the system block diagram from his talk, where you can see the PMU, which does the platform management, two Cortex R5 cores, four Cortex A53 cores, a GPU, and in the middle you see an FPGA. So everything I said before will be usually called the PS or processing system, and the blue stuff is usually called PL, programming logic. And inside this FPGA, you can see the small block, the VCU, and this VCU will be the focus of this talk. So if you want to use mainline Linux on the ZynqMP, this is very well supported. You further need some platform bring up code. Usually you use U-boot for that. You can use Barebox for that, or use the FSBL, which is the first stage bootloader provided by Xilinx. All of this code does platform bring up, and then Linux starts. And for that Linux, you can just use mainline. So there might be some parts, some special parts, especially when it goes into high performance network stuff, that mainline is not fully working yet. But to bring up a console and basic platform system, that's just fine. And what's a good thing about the ZynqMP is that Xilinx actively mainlines their drivers. So Xilinx guys are on the mailing lists and sending patches and upstreaming various drivers. So I'm expecting to get the mainline support even better. So now we have some ZynqMP SoC on our desk. There is a caveat. Not all of the ZynqMPs support the VCU, or actually have the VCU inside. you have to look at the specifier or the device ID. It usually starts with ZU, which stands for Zynq UltraScale. Then there follows a number, which is the size of the FPGA, more or less. Then a letter, which is the processor system identifier, which says if you have a dual-core or a quad-core processor, and if it includes a GPU. So only the E variants include the GPU. And now the interesting part is the last letter, which might be G or V. And only if you have a V there, your SoC actually has the VCU. So all of that I'm going to talk about really depends on your identifier of your SoC. It needs to have the V there, otherwise you don't have a VCU. Another aspect is I will totally focus on video encoding. The VCU also supports video decoding, but this is not supported by the mainline driver, and it might be the focus of a future talk, but not yet. Another aspect, I'm expecting basic knowledge about video encoding terminology. If you don't have it, watch this talk by Paul about video encoding. He gives 15 minutes, quick, concise, and really beginner-friendly introduction into video encoding. Just stay here with my talk, follow it. Most stuff should be totally clear, and if something is unclear, go and watch his talk to fill all the gaps. I can totally recommend this talk. So, the VCU. What are we dealing here with? Anyway, what does it do? How does it work? So, first step is look at the documentation. It's a 350 pages document. It's available from Xilinx on their website. You can just go there, download it. It explains all the hardware interfaces, the ports, the software architecture, which APIs to use, how the IP cores work, at least in part, how to do performance optimization for the VCU and your use case. If you are looking at this document, always check the date in the document. There is also a version, but I experienced that the version is not completely reliable. So let's look at the date. So let's start to look into this document. It tells something about the features. So the encoder engine is designed to process video streams using the HEVC and AVC standards. It provides complete support for these standards, including support for 8-bit and 10-bit color, Y-only, monochrome, 420 and 422 chroma formats, up to 4K UHD at 60 Hz performance. So what are the important parts? HEVC and AVC. HEVC is basically H.265. It's the same, it's just a different name. Both are used. AVC is H.264. It's the same, different names, but technically the same. So I will continue to use them interchangeably because different standards and different documentation uses the one or the other. And the second part is 4K UHD at 60 Hz. That means 4K frames are encoded with 60 frames per second, which is really impressive, and you want that for modern video encoding. So, how is it integrated in the SoC? Let's read further. The VCU is an integrated block in the programmable logic of selected Zynq UltraScale MPSoCs with no direct connections to the processing system. It contains encoder and decoder interfaces. The VCU also contains additional functions to facilitate the interface between the VCU and the PL. So we've seen this before in the block diagram. It's integrated in the programmable logic and has no direct connections to the processing system. What that means is that you have to program the FPGA in order to use the VCU. So without putting a bit stream into the VCU, into the FPGA, you won't be able to use the VCU. We have to keep this in mind, but that's how it is. Further, how does it work? The encoder is controlled by a microcontroller subsystem. VCU applications running on the APU use the Xilinx VCU control software library API to interact with the encoder microcontroller. The microcontroller interface is not user modifiable. So, interesting information. We have some microcontroller in there. We have to interact from the APU. The APU is basically the Cortex-A53. With this microcontroller, we cannot modify the firmware that's on the microcontroller, but instead we have to use some control software. Okay. Finally, some software coming into place. What's this software? The documentation reads on. The VCU control software is the lowest level software visible to VCU application developers. All VCU applications must use the Xilinx provided VCU control software directly or indirectly. The VCU control software includes custom kernel modules, custom user space library, and the control software encoder and control software decoder applications. The OpenMax IL OMX layer is integrated on top of the VCU control software. So, we have kernel modules, we have a user space library, we have some example applications, and we have an OpenMax integration layer implementation. The OpenMax is an API for video encoding and decoding specified by Kronos, like OpenGL. OpenMax allows us to use more generic applications, for example, GStreamer, to interact with the library. Okay, so there is some library. Where do we get it? GitHub. Xilinx provides this library on GitHub, including the code. So there are not only binaries, so no user space binary blobs, as you know from other drivers, but actual code. The license of this code is interesting. So it's MIT license with the small exception that you can only run the code on the Xilinx device or interact with Xilinx, to use it to interact with Xilinx devices. But we can look at this code and maybe we find some more information about the VCU in this code. So if you look at the code, you can see that the kernel driver registers some device. It's called dev Allegro IP. It's hard-coded, more or less. The user space library opens this device, and then the kernel implements various IOCTLs that are used by the user space and gets some opaque data structures from the user space and writes it straight to device memory. So what's in there? The buffers are filled by user space. We can look at the user space library code. And we see that there are various fields and especially there are physical addresses in these structs. So by passing these structs from user space without modification straight to the kernel driver to the memory or the device registers, this has security implications and so it might not be the best to actually use this user interface. So that's why we don't want to use the downstream driver. So we have an out of three kernel module. This kernel module provides a custom non-standard interface. There are physical addresses in this interface. So there is no chance in mainlining this driver at all. And furthermore, if you look at the Git log of the user space, you can only find Xilinx and Allegro DVT mail addresses there. So it's maintained and solely implemented, developed by Xilinx and Allegro DVT. So not really a community or open source project. So we might end up with something unmaintained in our user space. Possible pitfalls of not using these drivers, we are leaving the Xilinx path. So we are basically on our own. We still have to use the MCU firmware for the microcontroller. That means we have to use an unsupported and undocumented ABI to interact with the microcontroller. And this will bite us later, and we will see how. With the VCU control software, we saw how drivers in Linux should not work. So let's look at how video encoders usually work in mainline Linux. There are various media APIs defined in Linux. So we already saw OpenMax. This API is kind of dead. So it's specified by Kronos, implemented by a few user space libraries, but as vendors are able to implement this, or are supposed to implement this, they are able to add extensions, and there might be vendor-specific bugs in the libraries. So it's not really something, not an API that works consistently over different drivers and implementation. Then we have the video decode and presentation API for Unix, defined by NVIDIA. This API just refers to decoding, so we cannot use it for encoding. Another API is the VA API, the video acceleration API, which is defined and mostly used by Intel. For that, we have an implementation in Mesa, which uses DRM to talk to the kernel. This is mostly used for GPUs that support encoding. Due to this, it uses DRM like other GPUs. Both of these APIs are not really suited for the VCU, therefore. There is another API, the Video for Linux too, which includes all the media framework on Linux. This is mostly used for video capture. It also supports video output. And if you take a video output device and put it together with a video capture device, put them together, you get a mem-to-mem video device. So you can read some memory and write to the memory and transform video data with that, which is basically what encoder or decoder does. So we have a look further into this video for Linux too, especially the M2M drivers. Some examples for drivers that implement video for Linux M2M. So the VCodec driver, it's a test driver without actual hardware. This is used to verify the specification, the implementation, and also use to verify user space. Then we have the coder driver, which is on for the hardware encoder on the i.mx6. We have the Huntro driver, which is for the i.mx8. The Huntro driver is also topic in Paul's talk that I mentioned before. And the VC4 driver, which is used on the Raspberry Pi. The Video for Linux API is specified in the Linux kernel source. It has a very extensive specification. And to verify drivers, that drivers actually implement the API correctly, there is also a test suite that you have to run against your driver if you mainline any driver in Linux that implements this API. So this is really stable, and user space also should be able to rely on drivers correctly implementing this API. If you are talking about video for Linux devices and especially the mem-to-mem devices, we have to get some terminology straight, because otherwise you will have problems with understanding later. For more details on the API, look at Hans' talk at the ELCE 2019, which gives a status update and covers extensively the Video for Linux mem-to-mem API. The buffers, so we are exchanging buffers with a driver as an application, and these buffers are named from a user space point of view. So if you have an output buffer, it goes into the encoder driver, because from the application point of view, you are outputting data. And capture buffers come out of the encoder, because as an application, you are capturing some data from the driver. So in the middle, you have the device, and the device converts the data from the output to the capture device. Just to make sure, be aware that output and capture are not especially, might not be what you're expecting on the first guess. So I emphasize this: output into the encoder, capture out of the encoder. Then also in Video for Linux, there are two different types of encoders which are specified. Stateful encoders, which keep some state in the hardware or the firmware. The state mainly refers to reference frames, the rate control, and metadata handling. What all of this means, take a look at Paul's talk. If you have a stateless codec, you have all to do all of this in the software, but stateful encoders do this for you. Spoiler alert, the VCU actually is a stateful encoder, and we will later see why this is actually the case. So let's dive into the driver. Let's see how the driver interacts with the VCU, how it initializes the VCU, and how it actually encodes a video stream. First, look at the hardware interface. We have memory mapped registers and an SRAM that is memory mapped. Again, this is in the FPGA, and therefore its memory addresses that could be used for other devices in the FPGA, and it might just be that the VCU is there. It's also changeable because it's specified in the bitstream where the VCU is mapped. Then, if you're looking closer at the MCU, it turns out this is a microblaze microprocessor. As far as I know, this is not documented anywhere, but once you start to work with the MCU, it becomes pretty clear. For example, you write microblaze instructions into the SRAM to achieve a certain effects on the MCU. And this MCU also can access the system memory. It's, yeah, just the other way around. So, we said before, the MCU needs some firmware. This is binary data, we cannot modify it, so we have to load it. So first the driver resets the MCU, then it copies part of the firmware into the SRAM, then it copies part of the firmware into the system memory. There are these two different parts, they have different names, AL5EB firmware and AL5E firmware. And then it also has to tell the MCU where the second firmware in system memory is located, writes this address into a register, and from now on the MCU can access the firmware and run the code that's in the firmware. the driver and the MCU also have to interact with each other later on. They use a mailbox interface for that. There is one mailbox for each direction, so one mailbox from the driver to the MCU and another one on from the MCU to the driver. These mailboxes are located at the end of the SRAM. And the firmware knows where these, where to look for the mailboxes. And the mailboxes are just a chunk of memory. And in there, there is a head pointer and a tail pointer, so for reading and writing these mailboxes. The driver is actually responsible for initializing these pointers and the mailboxes. Otherwise, the MCU will go crazy. And there is an interrupt from the driver, or the APU, in fact, to the MCU, and an interrupt back to signal that the MCU or the driver should read from the respective mailbox. So, mailbox set up, firmware loaded, we are ready to go. The driver writes into some wake-up register, and it will hopefully receive an interrupt from the MCU, and in the mailbox there is an init message. So that means the MCU is alive. As a next step, we also have to send an init message to the MCU. There are a few more addresses in there, and we will get an acknowledgement by another init message from the MCU, and from that on, the MCU will just wait for further messages. Now, the MCU is put up. We are able to encode something. For that, we need an application that wants to encode something. The application opens the device, the video device, and the application uses the V4L2 API to configure the encoding parameters. This refers to the codec to use, which size the frames are, which rate control mode to use, and then the application queues buffers, so output buffers and capture buffers, as we've seen before. And then, according to the V4L2 specification, we get a stream on command to start encoding. And during all of this configuration, as I said before, there is no interaction with the VCU. Because the VCU has limited contexts. These contexts are called channels in the VCU terminology, while these contexts are limited, the V4L2 requires, in theory, infinite applications. So if you create already a channel for each application that starts, this violates the V4L2 API. So we have to delay it until it's actually necessary. So at this point, everything is configured and we are able to tell the MCU that we want to start encoding. So we send a create channel message. Either there is no response from the MCU, that means something went wrong, or it sends an error message, that also means something went wrong, but you have some information what went wrong, and or it replies with okay message. And then in this message, the MCU requests additional buffers for holding reference and intermediate frames. The driver has to allocate these buffers and send further messages to tell the VCU about where to find intermediate and reference frames. So, as I said, there might be no response or an error response from the VCU. And that actually happened for me when I was testing another firmware release. So, not the one I first tested, but another release. And it didn't work. And I looked closer at the messages, and it turned out the expected message size of the messages has changed during these releases. We have the source code of the control software, and when we look there, we see the sizes have changed, and even the content of the messages has changed. And that's what happened because we are using an undocumented and unstable, in fact, ABI to the MCU. So what are the solutions? We could stick to just one firmware version. That's not really a solution because there are bugs in the firmware which are fixed in later releases or additional features. So the driver should be able to support newer firmwares, but I'd like to also have backwards compatibility to keep using existing firmwares. So the firmware must be identified during loading. And then different messages and different setup methods have to be done with regard to the MCU to be compatible to other releases. For that, we have an abstraction layer for converting messages into the firmware-specific binary format in the driver. So we are able to configure the encoder for different firmware versions, finally. But the buffers are still in the driver and not the encoder. So we somehow need to tell the VCU which buffers to encode. For that, we have put stream buffer for the capture buffers. That's so still a bit of terminology. Stream buffers are for coded data, which are capture buffers in BFL2. We can put these with the put stream buffer, and then we can take the raw frames and the output buffers, send encode frame messages with this output buffer to the VCU, and it will start encoding. In this encode frame message, there are no reference frames. It's just one buffer or one address there. That means the VCU or the firmware chooses which frames to use as reference frames. And that's exactly why it's a stateful encoder. So we have no control about which reference frames to use, but this is all decided by the firmware. With the sending the buffers to the firmware, something interesting happened later. So I was able to run the VCU, but then I observed, okay, I'm configuring a frame rate, but the actual frame rate that I'm achieving is not the one that I'm expecting. And I saw that the time in the encoder that was spent in the encoder from the encode frame message until the respective response was exactly timed for the frame rate. But we are spending additional time in the driver and the user space, and that was why we didn't achieve the frame rate. So the encoder expects to receive a constant stream of frames even before it actually has to be encoded. And there are queues internal in the VCU that have to be used. So if you are just putting buffers into the VCU, it will actually encode with the correct frame rate. But that means buffers that are in the VCU are not on the BFL2 queues anymore. And for that, we require shadow queues to track the buffers that are in the VCU, because we might need to free the buffers again. And it is possible that the VCU won't react or won't return the buffers. And we have to know which buffers are allocated to be able to free them on errors or when stopping. So we have, as peculiarity two, the shadow queues. Then we sent a frame to the VCU, but we didn't get a response yet. In fact, we get a message back via mailbox, and we are looking into the capture buffer, and there is some data there. It's not in the beginning of the capture, so how do we figure out where the data is actually located? If you look at the messages, there is some address offset into this capture buffer, and this address points to a partition table. And in this partition table, we get the actual offset of the data in the capture buffer. this offset is not static and it might even change between frames. So we have to look up where to get the data, but that's okay. If you look closer at the data, it's a VCL NHL unit. That means video coded layer. So it's not metadata, but just the actual frame data that's in the buffers. This is something that's not expected of stateful encoders. And we have to generate this in the driver. So we need a metadata generator for the non-VCL NHL units. Because the application using the stateful encoder API expects the data to be there. So we have this additional metadata generator to satisfy user space. Our driver is still a stateful encoder because of the encode frame message, if you remember. So to sum up the peculiarities of the driver, we have this unstable firmware API, ABI, that we have to handle. So we require these abstraction layers for messages into the mailbox, which allow to handle different firmware versions. Then we have to use shadow queues to track buffers that we passed to the VCU and don't have them on the V4L2 queues anymore. That is necessary to reach the proper configured performance of the encoding. And we need this metadata generator because the VCU is stateful but does not produce the metadata. With that, let's look at the current state of the Allegro driver. It allows H.264 encoding. It allows different rate control modes like constant QP, variable bitrate, constant bitrate. So this is basic H.264 encoding functionality. The driver itself is currently in staging. It's about to move to mainline in Linux 5.12, hopefully. And if you want to have HEVC encoding, I posted a patch series on the Linux Media mailing list. You can get it from there, and from with that, the driver should be able to encode H.264 or HEVC. So if you want to use the driver on your SoC, then you have to use the Xilinx Vivado to configure the VCU and to generate a bitstream and load the bitstream into the FPGA. We saw this before. Bitstream configuration is necessary to use it. Then you have to add the device tree bindings for the VCU into your device tree. These are the mainline bindings are slightly different from the downstream drivings because of various reasons. So if you are using generated device tree overlay or something, then you have to make sure that you are actually using the mainline bindings instead of the ones that are in the generated device tree. And you have to enable the driver using the video Allegro DVT configure item. And with that, you should be able to use the encoder with a mainline Linux. With this understanding of the VCU and how the Allegro driver works, let's try to take a look into the future. What features I have in mind for the Allegro driver and what will come next. So the VCU features an encoder buffer. This encoder buffer has different names. It goes under L2 cache, prefetch buffer, cache level 2. But everything just means the same. It just has different names on different API levels. In the end, it's a cache for reference frames directly inside the VCU, which uses block RAM or ultra RAM. This allows to reduce the load on the axi bus from the main memory to the VCU. And this is good for the performance of the VCU. This is not mainline yet, I'm not completely sure how the encoder buffer works internally, so that's the reason why it's not there. Another thing related to the AXI ports are performance monitors directly at these AXI ports, which measure the number of transfers and inferring from this the transfer rate. This helps for a performance analysis, especially for enabling the encoder buffer. So how much effect you get by enabling the encoder buffer or not enabling it. It's also not mainline. Here the reason is that I'm not completely sure how to expose this to the user space. A third feature that might come are slices. So for slices, you split the raw frame into multiple slices which are encoded independently. This helps with the performance for decoding, for example, because the slices can be decoded independently, which means in parallel, so you get a better latency there. And it also helps to prevent error propagation through the frames because these are decoded independently. You have errors only in one of the slices and the other one is perfect. The problem here is that, as we saw before, the VCU decides where to put the coded data in the capture buffers. And with slices, one slice is in the beginning of the capture buffer, but the other slice is right in the middle. And we somehow have to handle this. We could add filler data between the slices, but this avoids the idea of compressing video because we transfer all this filler data, which means nothing, but still uses bandwidth and decoding power. We could also just take the buffers we get from the VCU, copy the data out of these buffers, put them into separate capture buffers and return these capture buffers to user space. But then we are doing copying again, also all the data would be already there. And a third solution with more or less the same problem is moving the data in the capture buffer and pushing all of it to the beginning of the buffer and thus having to copy later slices, but we would still be able to have no copy for the first slice. And I'm not sure about the least bad solution for that. That's why it's not implemented in the mainline driver yet. Then another thing. The ZynqMP has an I.O. MMU, which is located in the processing system, so not in the FPGA. This allows to have virtual device addresses compared to actual physical addresses, and this improves the security of the overall system. This I haven't properly tested this yet, especially not with the VCU. It might be possible that it just works, but I'm not sure. This is especially important if we are not allocating buffers on the VCU, but importing buffers from some other capture device like a camera. And this allows to use this would allow to use zero copy, so just take the buffers from the camera and pass it through to the VCU. But if there is an I.O. MMU in place and the addresses do not match, the VCU might not be able to use the addresses of the capture device. And there might be surprises. Then there is the PL RAM on the ZynqMP. This is a separate memory directly connected to the FPGA. This allows to reduce the load on the AXI bus. But on the other hand, so especially if devices, capture devices are implemented in the FPGA, and these might just read the data from some sensor and put it into this RAM. And if the VCU is able to access this RAM directly, we again are able to avoid copies. And for big frames like 4K, this is a lot of data. And this would really improve the performance of the system. The problem here is that the MCU only has a 2 GB window into this memory. And it includes not only the output buffers, which are captured, but also the firmware, the capture buffers, and even the reference frames. So all of that won't go to system memory, but to this PL RAM if we want to read our captured frame, raw frames from the PL RAM. This is a very interesting use case. It's a bit limited due to this window, but indeed very interesting. So I'm very interested in getting this to work, but haven't implemented it yet. So further under-supported features, the VCU allows dual-pass encoding, which means that you encode the video stream once, check the results of this encoding process, use it to gather statistics, and then use this data to encode the video stream a second time, but adjust the encoding parameters based on these statistics to improve your encoding results. This might, for example, refer to iframe locations. So you can put an iframe at a scene change and avoid artifacts there. Another non-supported feature is the Zynq IP from Xilinx. This is a special IP core which allows to synchronize the VCU encoding based on DMA transfers from the capture device, so you can start encoding before the entire frame has been transferred to memory, which reduces the latency because you can don't have to wait until all the frame data is there, but you start encoding before that. Then, as said in the beginning, the VCU also supports video decoding. On the lowest level, the interface is similar to what's done for the encoder. So you have SRAM, you have system memory, you have some firmwares, and you have a mailbox interface with messages. This is not supported because I haven't looked at the messages there and didn't implement anything there. And for properly supporting a decoder, also the user's interface, it is the V4L2 decoder interface has to be exposed to user space, and there is nothing there yet as well. For the decoder, there is also, again, another special IP core, which is another RAM controller. This RAM controller is optimized for access patterns of decoders and allows to reduce the transfers. Because the decoder is not implemented, this is also not implemented. So to come to a conclusion of my talk, try and test the Allegro driver, its mainline. And it should just work. If it doesn't work for you, report bugs, request new features, or just send patches for this driver. If you want to send patches, use the Linux Media mailing list for that and put me on CC, because then I will definitely read it. Also, I'm also following the Linux Media list. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and let's move to the discussion. Thank you.